walking the same old road for miles and miles. If you've been hearing the same old voice tell the same old lies, if you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, there's a better life. There's a better life. If you've got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you've got chains, he's a chain. Search for the light of day in the dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. We've all run to things we know just ain't right. There's a better life. There's a better life.
Put your hands together. Put your hands in the air. Just think about it and give him some good praise right now. Because he broke a chain for you, whether you knew it or not this week. He did it, and he'll do it again. Let's continue in our worship.
I once was lost.
Amen, amen. I want you to do something. I want you to close your eyes right where you are. Everyone close your... This song, next chorus we're about to sing, you all know it. You'll know it well. And I want you to close your eyes and I want you to just think about the words of it and what it means. And I want you to recognize our Lord for who He is. Let's sing, Philip.
He is Lord. He is Lord. He is risen from the dead and He is Lord.
Every knee shall bow.
Every knee shall bow. Every tongue confess that Jesus. Jesus Christ is Lord.
Proclaim it this morning one more time. Sing it out.
He is Lord. He is Lord. He is risen from the dead, and He is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord.
Amen, amen. He is Lord this morning in our lives, and I'm so thankful for it. I'm going to invite all of our kids to come up here. Come on, kids. I don't care if you go to school or not. Come on. Maybe you're a dropout. It don't matter. Come on. If you're a kid, get up here with me. Join me up front. All the kids up here and teachers. And teachers. Y'all thought you got out of it. If you're a teacher or you work at a school in the school system, get on up here. We want all of you to come up. Yes, yes. Come on, can we let these kids know how much we love them and these teachers? Yes. This is so awesome. Here we go, here we go. Look at this. This is great. I mentioned this last week, we just recognized, I guess, my third anniversary as pastor here. Been here 3 years now, and when we walked in the door 3 years ago, my two kids were the only two kids in the church. And last week, Sister Nikki told me we had 15 kids in kids' church, and look at this. Look at what God is doing. This is amazing. This is absolutely amazing. I'm gonna ask my wife, where she's over here taking pictures. You take pictures, that's fine. But I'm going to ask Miss Nikki as well if she would come up here. She is our kids director, and she, every week in and week out, ministers to your kids and to these kids and makes an impact in their lives that we know is going to last them for a long, long time. Yeah, we can clap for Miss Nikki, absolutely. So I'm going to ask Mitzi and Nikki and Philip to join me over here, and we're going to lay hands on these kids. We'll all grab a couple and put your hands on them. And if you stretch your hands this way, we're going to pray a special blessing of protection. If you watched the news this morning or last night, we need protection in our lives. There's been two mass shootings in the last 24 hours in our country, and we need protection in our lives, and our little ones need that for sure because many times they can't take care of themselves. So we're going to believe that God's going to protect them, take care of them, and use them to be instruments of the faith. So Philip, come on over here. I need you to help me. Lay hands on people. Don't be shy. Just grab a couple of people. Put your hands on somebody near you. And let's pray together. Let's pray, kids. Father, we thank you, dear God, for all of the little ones, dear Father. Jesus, you said to send the little kids unto you, dear God. And you received them, dear Father, with love, dear God, and adoration, dear God, in your eyes for them. And God, we love these children, dear God. We know, dear God, that this generation, dear Father, is tried and they are pushed and pulled by the world and the culture that they are living in. But God, we know, dear Lord God, that you, God, have them in the palm of your hand, and you are their protector. You are their provider, dear God. You are their leader, their guide, dear Father. You are the comfort and the peace that they need, dear Father, and the strength that they need, Father. We ask you to minister, God, in and through them, God, as they start back their school year. We ask you, God, to protect them, dear Father, give them strength. Help their little lights to shine, dear God. Let something that they learn, dear God, in kids' church on a Sunday, dear God. God, may it be carried into their schools, dear God, and shared, dear God, with those that are around them, we pray, dear Father. We ask you, dear Lord God, to minister to our teachers as well, God. Each one that is involved in our school system, dear God. Use them, dear God, as instruments of the faith. God, we know that times are trying for teachers, and it's difficult, and they're dealing with so many types of children, dear Father. And we ask you, God, to give them patience, give them understanding. God, give them the stamina, dear God, and the encouragement they need, dear God, the power through this school year, 2019 and 2020. We thank you, we honor you, and we bless each child and each teacher right now. Be with the parents as well, dear God, and the caregivers, God, that take care of these little ones, that they may, God, be strengthened, God, and continue to, God, lead these children in the faith day in and day out. We love you, we honor you, and we love all these kids in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen, amen. Y'all hang on right here, hang on. Pastor Phillip's got a gift for every one of you. Every one of you, if you didn't close your eyes during that prayer, you don't get a gift. So, but everybody else does. That's for the adults too. The adults get one too. Every kid is getting a gift. Hand sanitizer. Who would have thought that kids would need hand sanitizer? But it's one of the most requested items from teachers. Hand sanitizer. Did you get one? Hey, he's got one for you. Did our teachers get a... We got some more. Phillip's got some more back here. We're going to make sure they get one. Oh, give Miss Nikki one too. She needs one too. Yeah. All right, get out of your seat. We're going to dismiss our kids to Kids Church. Get out of your seat. Welcome your neighbor. Hug somebody. High five them. Let these kids know too on their way out how much you love them this morning. We are beginning a new series today, as you see on the screen, called Others. Others. I mean, that could go in so many different directions, right? Others. It's back to school Sunday all day long. We'll be finishing this thing up with our splash bash and some dinner together with pizza, and you all are invited. Even if you're not a kid, even if you don't want to get wet, you can come out. We'll have pizza for you. Drinks for you. We'll have a good time. Last year we had so many come out and just watch, and it's a lot of fun to watch. Watch John Bartlett go down a 100-foot water slide. It's something to take in. It really is. He's not the only one. Oh no. It's a safety test. We talked about it last week. The adults have to test it, right? But we're prayed over our kids, and we hope they have a wonderful school year. This year is especially important and significant for my family because our smallest, our youngest, little Spencer, starts school this year. Next Monday week, she starts school, and we don't know whether to laugh or cry, to cheer or be sad. We don't know whether we should throw a party or crawl under the covers. It's a big change. It's a big, big change, and I'm sure all of you parents would agree. Having kids changed my life. How many of you parents can agree with that? Yes, Jeff and Mel raised their hands quick. First one's up. Having kids changes your life. But the biggest change that happened in my life when I had kids was this. All of a sudden, life was less about me and more about others. Of all the changes that took place in my life when we had kids, the one thing that I noticed the most, that life, all of a sudden, after 33 years, was no longer about me. Now, it sounds like my wife didn't come first in my life, but it did. But kids made me recognize that it's about others. Why? Because they're so dependent. I just said it's hard for kids sometimes to protect themselves. Well, it's hard for kids to take care of themselves. Our oldest is 7, and he's just now getting to the point where he's gaining some independence and starting to do things on his own. And, Dad, I can do my own Pop-Tart. I'm like, hey, go for it. I don't have to get up. Yes. But they completely depend on us to lead them, to love them, to serve them. And all of a sudden, life was less about me and it was more about others. The same is true with our relationship with God, with my relationship with Him. We exist to serve and to honor Him. And then in turn, we naturally, one would think, we would love and serve others. These are the values that we hold here. You look anywhere. You look in your bulletin. You hear it all the time. We value loving, serving, and growing. We believe that God has called us to love Him and love others. Serve Him and serve others. I've done an entire series on this. And then for us to grow together. It's significant for us. It means something to us. But it is not easy to make the statement that there should be less about me and more about others. But Jesus said it as he invited people to follow him. He said, whoever wants to be my disciple must do what? Deny themselves. If you want to be a follower of Christ, one of the first things you must do is deny yourself. What does that say? It's not about me. But yet sometimes, I'm going to jump right in the deep end since it's a splash bash day. I'm going to make a splash here because sometimes we're all in it for what God can do for us. And as we just finished our puzzle series, when God leaves us puzzled, we get angry. We get frustrated. And we have to realize it ain't about us. It's not about me. I hope you came today looking for something special from the Lord, and I hope he gives it to you. But at the end of the day, your showing up today has nothing to do with you, really. Unless you are going to take what God does inside of you and translate it to how you can serve others. That's what it's about. That's why we're here. It's all about the others. It's all about them. We live in a very self-centered, selfish culture. And I'm hoping this series will teach us to be a little selfless and stay more focused on loving God and loving others. I'm going to show you a familiar text before we get to our main text, and it's Matthew 22. And it says this: hearing that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, the Pharisees got together. One of them, an expert in the law, tested him with this question: teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law? Jesus replied, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. That's the greatest commandment. This is the first and greatest commandment. That's what I just said. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. The two greatest commandments from the Lord are these: love God first, and then love others. There's nothing more that God expects out of us than to love him and love others. And then everything else is secondary. What are the greatest commandments, Jesus? Love me. Love others. Love me. Love others. But how many of us can say today that we truly, truly love others? We love everyone. Do we put ourselves in a position to come face to face with others, those we may disagree with, those we might not have anything in common with, to show them the love that we have for them? Or do we find ourselves clicking together with those that we are comfortable with and only showing them love? I heard a pastor say this week at a conference that Mitzi and I attended in Birmingham, and he said, it's hard to hate someone up close. That's powerful. It's hard to hate someone up close. When you get close enough to someone and you let them into your life and you cling to them and try to make a difference in their life, you get down to the nuts and bolts of what's going on inside their life, it's hard to hate them, even if you disagree with everything about them. Because the love of God has to just flow out of you if you genuinely love him. And it has to flow out of you into others. Through this series, God's going to challenge us to draw closer to him. And as a result, we're going to see how our love for Jesus should be evident in how we love and serve others. And so today we're going to begin by first looking at sharing Christ with others. John's Gospel, chapter 20, verse 19. Just a few short verses. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, on the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, here's the disciples together on a Sunday night, hanging out. Jesus has died. He's been buried. And now the tomb is empty, as they've just discovered. And Jesus told the disciples that he would come to them, that they should be waiting. And here's how he finds them. With the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." May God add his blessing to his word this morning. I want you to imagine for a minute these men, these disciples that Jesus had trained. These men had walked with Jesus 3 years or so as he preached the gospel, as he healed the sick, as he raised the dead. Being taught by Jesus. Imagine for a moment these disciples who walked every day for these few years with Jesus Christ. Day in, day out, him pouring into them, investing into their lives, explaining to them what would take place. He told them, "Listen, guys, I'm going to die. You all know how the gospel goes. I'm going to die." Why would they not believe him? Because after seeing all the miracles he's performed and everything come to pass so far, just like he said it would. From the time that John the Baptist said, "No, there's a Savior coming." They knew this guy, this Jesus was legit. He tells them, "I'm going to die. You going about your business, because in 3 days I'm going to come back and find you." Find us? Oh yeah, by the way, I'm going to be raised from the dead. God's going to resurrect me from the dead, and I'm going to live for eternity and offer love and grace and salvation to all mankind. The disciples know exactly what's going to happen here. So Jesus goes to the cross. He suffers a brutal death. And 3 days later, what do you think the disciples are doing? Now, you would think that if Jesus had told them, "Hey, after 3 days, I'm going to come and see you." Now, I don't know about you, but when I know someone's coming, I'm looking out for them. I'm looking out for them. I bought a truck recently. Some of you have seen me riding a truck. So I sold my car. Sold my car this week, and somebody sent me a message about my car, and they said, "Hey, can we come to your house and look at it?" I was like, "Sure." So what do? I go in the front living room, and I open the door, and I open the blinds so I can see out front. Why? Because I was expecting someone. But yet the disciples are locked behind doors, hiding. These are the same men that have walked with Jesus, have talked with Jesus. And you would think that they would be out there telling the people, "Oh, you just watch." I mean, I would. I'd be the one out there telling my friends, "Hey, you want to see a cool trick? Watch this. Just hang on. He's coming, I promise you. This is going to be awesome. You remember that guy they hung on that cross? Just watch. He's alive. You just wait." I'd be wanting to blow people's minds. But here they are, hiding. Hiding from the Jewish leaders. Locked behind a door. So no one can find them. The Bible says it. With the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders. They were cowering in fear because of the enemies of Christ that were around them. They have been connected to the greatest gift of all, the grace of Jesus. I don't expect you to get real excited today. This is gonna be one that punches you right in the side, I hope. They were understood the greatest gift of all, and it was the grace of Jesus. They've just witnessed it. Everything that he says so far has come to pass. And yet they're scared to share that gift with anyone else. Have you ever been there? For those of you, and I hope it's all of you, that are Christians this morning, and Jesus has saved your soul, you have the greatest gift known to humanity. The greatest gift ever. And yet sometimes we are too fearful to share it with others. Why are we so afraid? If we have something that people really need, why are we so afraid? Are we afraid that we're going to offend someone? Are we afraid that they're going to make fun of us? Are we afraid that they're going to deny our offer? We started off the year talking about this, the Hitting the Mark series. And it's a good time for us to kind of have a reminder here. Why are we so afraid to share the greatest gift of all with those that are around us? We don't want to be pushy. We don't want to sound like a sales rep. We don't want to be silly in their eyes. We're afraid maybe we won't get it right. Pastor, what if they ask me questions about the Bible? What if I don't have answers for them? Who cares? They need Jesus. They need his love and grace and mercy. And if we're worried and fearful about being humiliated and looking silly and being turned down, then we need to strap up our boots and get a hold of ourselves. Because there's a world out there that's lost and dying and going straight to hell. And hell is as real as heaven, people. Oh, Pastor's preaching on hell today. Yes, I am. Because I got loved ones that are headed straight there if something doesn't happen. And that tears me apart. Maybe your whole family's saved and going to heaven. Praise the Lord for it. But mine's not. And I find myself in the place of the disciples, camped out behind a locked door, scared to share my faith with them. Why? Why do I not have this boldness? Well, there's a good reason, and it's right here in Scripture. It's right here in Scripture. Here are these disciples that walk with Jesus, cowering down, hiding behind locked doors. And then in Acts chapter 4, we see something amazing. We have disciples that are scared to death of the religious leaders and the keepers of the law in Jerusalem. But yet, just a few short chapters later in Acts chapter 4, these same disciples are preaching salvation in front of the masses, knowing that if they keep doing it, they're going to be arrested, and not caring at all. Peter is standing there preaching to the masses and could care less what happens to him. Peter, the same one who denied Jesus 3 times when asked if he knew him. We've seen Peter at least twice that he was scared to death of his faith and sharing it with others. And now here he is out in front of the masses, knowing that he's going to be arrested and eventually probably put to death. He doesn't care. What happened? What changed that Peter went from the guy that was so fearful to admit that he was a follower of Jesus, hiding behind locked doors, to being so bold in his faith that he didn't care what came of it? Here's what happened. He didn't do it alone. Jesus came on the scene and he said, "Peace be with you. I'm sending to you the Holy Spirit." Jesus tells Peter and all the disciples, "I'm sending the Holy Spirit." And on the day of Pentecost, we know that the Spirit of God came and imparted himself into their lives. That is the difference. That is the difference in a person that's fearful to share their faith and someone who is bold. The Lord was with them. The Bible says that Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers and elders of the people, if we are being called to account today for an act of kindness shown to a man who was lame and are being asked how he was healed, then know this, you and all the people of Israel, it is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man stands here healed. Jesus is the stone you builders rejected, which has become the cornerstone. Salvation is found in no one else." The religious leaders, the teachers of the law, they were shocked by the passion of Peter and John. The same guys that had denied the faith, the same guys that had denied knowing Jesus, are now standing in front of the masses preaching the gospel to all that will hear it. And the religious leaders, the Sadducees, stand here and they are amazed and shocked. Why? Because the Bible says that these are ordinary men. These are just ordinary, uneducated people. And yet they are making an effort to reach the masses with the gospel. They are concerned with others. How many of us are really, 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 really concerned with this crowd? When I first came to pastor here 3 years ago, somebody came up to me, and I can't remember who it was, and if I did, I wouldn't tell you anyway. Somebody came up to me, and I was new. I mean, I hadn't been here probably a month or two, and somebody said, "Pastor, I would really like for you to go visit my niece." I said, "Okay, is she sick?" "No, she needs Jesus." I said, "Well, have I met her?" "Well, no, 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 but you can just go by and see her. Talk to her about the Lord." And I said, "Well, maybe you'd have a better shot at doing that." And they just looked at me so puzzled. They probably thought to themselves, "Well, I'm their family. I'm just an ordinary, uneducated person. You're the pastor. You've gone to school for this." But wait. You have the same grace and love that I have. If you call yourself a Christian, mine's no different than yours. Your cup runneth over just like mine. If it doesn't, that's your fault. So many times we want to put it on other people to take responsibility for reaching those that are close to us who need to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. Well, I'm here to tell you, I have my own job of reaching those that are close to me. And I don't mean this in an arrogant or prideful way, but if this church supports me financially thinking that I'm going to go out there and try to witness to everybody in their family to get them saved for the gospel, then you're missing your calling. It is not a suggestion from Jesus that we go and minister and try to reach and disciple those here and across the world. That's not a suggestion. It is a calling. You are so much more likely to reach those in your family, in your workplace, in your home than I am. If you can get them here, I'll be glad to impart something into them on Sundays or during the week if I can. I'm not stepping down. Y'all know me better than that. But you're going to be the key to their salvation. Let me share something with you real quick as we close. Listen to this. This month, not this month, last month, July, the Barna Group. I don't know if you've ever heard of the Barna Group. They do a lot of studies. They do statistics and all this kind of stuff, specifically related to religious and church studies sometimes. They released some staggering results from a study they did. This is not even a month old. This was on July the 11th, okay? Here's what they found, and I quote, only 15% of Christians, what's the number? 15, okay, out of 100%. Only 15% of Christians say that they were introduced to Christ by someone outside of their family. Whoa! I almost wrecked my car when I heard it. I was driving down the road and I heard it on the radio. I was like, what? Even to the point that I went and found this study online just to make sure I heard it right. Only 15% of Christians say they were led to the Lord or introduced to Christ by someone other than their family. So then my question to you is, whose responsibility is it anyway? The power of influence in the family structure is absolutely tremendous. Others depend on you to share your faith. Your family depends on you to share your faith. We are to be salt and light to the world. It's all in the good book. We're to be salt and light to others. So here's my question here. What are you doing to reach your family? We're going to start right there and park the car. What are you doing to reach your family? When's the last time you talked to someone in your family about Jesus? When's the last time? Some of you have kids, don't know Jesus. If they die without knowing Christ, they will not go to heaven. It's in the Bible. Some of you have parents, don't know Jesus. Some of you have nieces, nephews, cousins, aunts, uncles, brothers, sisters, don't know Jesus. When's the last time you talked to them? When's the last time? When's the last time you offered the gift or you hiding behind a locked door? Today, at this very moment, maybe not the next moment, but this very moment, you still have an opportunity. You may not tomorrow. There might be a mass shooting in Walmart. It happened in El Paso. It happened. Something could happen just like that. Pastor, you're just trying to make us feel guilty and scare us. No, I'm just telling you the reality. I'm not here to make you get excited this morning. I'm here to hit you right there. Right there. Because I don't know about you, but I am guilty as charged. And for the last few weeks as I've been preparing this sermon series, God has spoken to me and he has pricked my heart. And even this week as we were at a conference, it was confirmation that I needed. That we have to be more evangelistic in nature and how we walk out our life. We have to be concerned with others. Less about me, more about. Less about me, more about. Say it with me, all of it. Less about me, more about.